Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome everyone to Lord of the Worlds. Today, inshallah, we'll be exploring some of the key questions which is relevant to us here in Sydney as young Muslims and as older Muslims too. One of the key questions which you always ask ourselves is what relevance does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have for us here today? Living here in Sydney, Australia, over 1400 years after the revelation of the Prophet ﷺ, so far away from the Holy Lands, in the 21st century, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean to us? And what relevance does He have in our relationship with Him? To aid us along the way, inshallah, we'll have our beloved Mashiach, who will be addressing us throughout the day, and my colleague, Brother Muhammad Zaud. But also aiding us will be our local family from Sydney, the Abdullah family. The Abdullah family are born and bred in Sydney, and there's a, mashallah, very halal photo. But first, before we get into it, we're just going to explain a little bit about the Abdullah family. They're born here, they grew up here. They moved around, they rented, so they were in Campbelltown at one stage, Liverpool sometimes. They even went to the Central Coast for a bit, and Wollongong. And then they went back to Auburn and Lakemba and Bankstown. And now they're sort of in between houses. And I want to introduce you to the oldest member of the family, Muhammad, and then his wife Sarah, the two in the middle. And to the right is Maryam, the youngest of the two, and to the left is Abdullah. But what we're going to do first is we're going to introduce Maryam. She's given us permission, alhamdulillah, to have a sneak peek into her room. She tied it up for us, so we're just going to go in and have a little look and understand a bit more about Maryam. Maryam, on the outside, her room looks like a normal room. It's pink, like any other girl her age. She's religious, so she tries really hard to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she tries her utmost best to do what is right. At the same time, she's striving in uni to do well. So it's a struggle. And if we look at her bookshelf, what we'll notice is that Maryam, mashallah, she has a donation tin. And she gives $1 to $2 a day. She puts it in the tin, the spare change from her train. But sometimes she thinks, what good is this $1 or $2? This $1 or $2 which I'm giving compared to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq's entire wealth which he gave for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Really, does it really matter? Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really accept this from me? And we also see that she attends weekend Islamic courses. And she feels when she does attend that she comes closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But still, is it really enough? The Sahaba, the amount of knowledge they had, the scholars, the Salihin, does it compare? And also she tries to recite 1 to 2 verses of Quran at least every single day. She picks up the Quran, she tries to understand what she's reciting. It's consistent. But at the same time, she's no Abdullah bin Amr. She's not a person who sits there and recites the entire Quran the whole night. Really, is this going to be accepted? Is this relevant? But also, like every other girl her age, Maryam doesn't mind going on her iPhone and, you know, going on Facebook for a bit. But mashallah, Maryam, she's very cautious. She makes sure that whenever she goes on Facebook, if there's any friend requests, she only accepts the people that she knows are good and that are going to benefit her. But also, whenever she types anything, her status, she's watched the fiqh of Facebook by Suhaib Webb, so she knows to make sure not to post anything bad or slandering. But also, she likes to go on YouTube. And sometimes she tunes in and listens to Shaykh Shadi's lectures, as well as Shaykh Wissam's and Shaykh Binaz, Shaykh Abu Adnan's and Shaykh Amos, and any other Shaykh who can benefit her. And she foregoes watching these other things which are a bit more funny, because she's trying to do what she can to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But really, who does she turn to ensure that this is going to be accepted? Does this sacrifice really mean anything? What about the brothers who are trying to pray their 5 daily prayers inside the mosque every single day? This effort which they make, is it really accepted by Allah? What about the family who tries to fast outside of Ramadan? They do it together as a family. It's not the fasting of Dawood alayhi salam, day on, day off, but they're doing their best. And what about the brothers and sisters who give to Human Appeal and Islamic Relief and to IDU and to Muslim Aid and the various other organizations? What about them? The little they give, the $50 they give, the $100 they give, Allah has eternal, His wealth is beyond our comprehension. Does it really mean anything to Him? Inshallah, I'd like to invite Sheikh Shedi up to the stage as he's going to share with us the importance of understanding one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Shakur, the most appreciative.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace be upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah Almighty, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, with an early morning on Sunday, where most of us like to sleep in, Allah Azza wa Jalla reward every single one of you for being here today. And I begin with the greetings of Islam and I say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. It seems that yet you are still asleep. So inshallah I'll wake you up again and I say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillah, that's half awake. Brothers and sisters, there's no greater gathering than a gathering that we get together for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And a gathering that we want to learn more about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord that we worship. You stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jal minimum of 5 times a day. And you contemplate of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you think of Allah Azza wa Jal many times during the day or night. But it's important for me as a Muslim to know more about the Lord that I worship. Who is this Lord that I worship? What's His attributes? This great Lord that created this great universe and created you and everything around you. You must have this minimal knowledge of your Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the beauty of knowing Allah Azza wa Jal more is the more that you know Allah, is the more you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more you love Allah, is the more you get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. So the more you know of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the more that you love Allah Azza wa Jal. And you become so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you learn about those great attributes of Allah, the one that's for Allah and only for Allah and no one but Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned to Himself 99 names. But me as a Muslim, I must believe in one thing. Does Allah Azza wa Jal have only 99 names and attributes? The answer is obviously no. Allah Azza wa Jal has unlimited attributes because He is the Lord of the universe. And from amongst His names and attributes is a shakur, the appreciative. A shakur is one of the great names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the names of Allah Azza wa Jal that Allah describes and attributes to Himself. And I'm asked to speak about the shakur. A shakur, the appreciative. But I don't know where to begin from. I don't know where to end at. When we are talking about the one that has no beginning and has no end, and that's Allah Azza wa Jal. Where do I begin from? Where do I end at? When we are talking about Allah, the one that has no beginning and the one that has no ending, the Lord of the universe, the Lord of the world. Ash-Shakur. Ash-Shakur. That term, that word, in particular for Arabs, it sounds very, very familiar, which comes from a shukr. And a common term that we'll always use when someone is generous to you, gives you something, helps you with something, you say to them, shukran, thank you. So shukran in Arabic means thank you. Is there any connection between the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ash-Shakur, and Shukran? Yes, there is a connection. Well, the word al-shakur comes from the word and the source of al-shukr, which is thanks. But here, when we attribute this word to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah attributed this word to Himself, where He says about Himself in the Quran al-Kareem, إِنَّهُ لَغَفُورٌ شَكُورٌ. Allah Azza wa Jalla says about Himself that He is the most forgiving and the shakur, the appreciative. It means, and listen to this carefully, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a lot for the little that you do. And I'm going to repeat that. So you could know the greatness of your Lord, Allah Almighty. Allah your creator. Allah your sustainer. The one that He gives a lot for the little that you do. And that's why He attributed Himself al-shakur, the appreciate. Al-shakur is the one that you do so little actions, but Allah gives you so much in return. You do so little for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah rewards you so great in return. You sacrifice so little for Allah, but you find Allah azza wa jal granting you so much reward that you yourself say, Ya Rab, where did I get all these rewards from? Well, that's why Allah azza wa jal attributed to Himself and called Himself a shakur. Because He gives you so much, a lot, for the little actions that you do. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says about a man who was in the middle of the desert, sees this well of water, drinks from it, and then he sees a thirsty dog, an animal, a thirsty dog. So this man, with some sympathy and rahmah and mercy in his heart, he says, it looks like that this dog is a lot more thirsty than me. Let me quench his thirst. So he goes with his shoes and he fills it up with water. And then he gives that water to that dog to drink from. And then what happens in return? Allah Azza wa Jal makes this man enter the paradise for a little action like that. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal named Himself the Shakur, the appreciative. Little action. A small deed. A small action, and Allah Azza wa Jal gives you so much in return. In another narration, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about a prostitute from Bani Israel. She also saw a thirsty dog. She gave the dog water. In return, Allah forgave her and made her enter the paradise. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed Himself. And that's why Allah named Himself al-Shakur, the appreciative. Another narration where the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, he says, a man is in the paradise. A man is happy in the paradise, moving and going from one place to other in the paradise. So happy. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam asked, why is this man in the paradise? So the reply comes back, he is a man that saw a branch of a tree that was harming people while they used to travel on that path. So he removed that branch. So Allah made him enter the paradise. Allahu Akbar! So little action! A small action! Feeding a dog! Giving water to a thirsty dog! Removing a branch that harms people! Removing something on the ground! Helping someone! Smiling to someone! You do something so little! And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you great reward in return. That's why He is the Shakur. That's why He is the Shakur. That's why He is the appreciative that gives a lot for the little that you do. And look what Allah Azza wa Jal says to what He had prepared for you. Yes. What He had prepared for you. For the little actions that you give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 5 daily prayers, 2 fajr, 4 dhuhr, 4 asr, 3 maghrib, 4 isha. Keep away from the haram. Give 2.5% from your money, zakat, sadaqah. Fast the days and the month of Ramadan. Little actions here and there. You give it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sake of Allah, that you worship Allah. So what does Allah say to you in return? أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِي أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِي الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. You think you do much for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We think we do much for Allah Almighty. Let's be realistic. We don't do much at all. We do so little for Allah. Few prayers here, few donations there, few lessons that we attend there. If we compare what we do for Allah Azza wa Jal in comparison to what we do for this dunya, we do so, so, so little. What does Allah Azza wa Jal say? Allah, He says, I had prepared for my righteous servants. I had prepared for you. Those little actions that you do, those few prayers that you pray, that few dollars that you give, those few days that you fast, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, I had prepared for my servants where no eyes had ever seen, no ears had ever heard of, and not even a heart or a mind can even think of. You know what, my brother? You know what, my sister? Just sit down and dream. Dream of this beautiful land with beautiful gardens and beautiful rivers and beautiful fountains and mountains. Dream of this palace that you continue to contemplate and think of and dream of, a massive mansion, massive palace that you know yourself and does not exist on the surface of this earth, but you continue to ponder and you continue to think and you continue to imagine and you continue to build, and you know that this such a land and such a garden and such a mansion and such a palace would never ever exist on the surface of this earth. You know what? Allah Azza wa Jal had prepared better for you in the past. Allah had prepared something better for you in the paradise. For what in return? For what? For what in return that Allah Azza wa Jal had prepared for you in the paradise? For the little action that you do. That's why he called himself al-Shakur. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, about the last man that comes out of the hellfire, he is to be the last man to enter the paradise. So here we're talking about the worst Muslim ever existed on the surface of this earth. The last person who comes out of the hellfire, who is the last person to enter the paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after He takes him out of the hellfire, Allah will cast him on the river of life. He comes out of the hellfire, his flesh and his bones are melted. So Allah Azza wa Jal will cast him on the river of life. So Allah brings his life back and his flesh back and his bones back. So when he comes back, he says, Allah had given me what he did not give to anyone else. What are you talking about? You are the last person that comes out of the hellfire, and you think Allah had given you what he did not give anyone else? He is the Shakur. I appreciate it. And then, from a distance, this is what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says in this authentic hadith. He sees a very nice tree with a very nice streaming river next to it. So he says, Ya Rab, Ya Allah, Ya Shakur, Oh Allah, the Lord of the universe, would you allow me to sit under and shade myself under this nice tree and drink from this beautiful water that's flowing next to that tree? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, Oh my servant, I will allow you to do that under the condition that you don't ask me for anything else after it. So he says, Ya Rab, I agree. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits him to go under that tree, shade himself under that tree, drink from that beautiful streaming water, and while he's there, he's sitting down, loving life, thinks, and he says, Allah had given me what he did not give anyone else. What are you talking about? You haven't even seen anything yet. And then, While this man is under that tree and drinking from that water, he sees another tree, better than the tree that he is sitting under. And next to it, another river or streaming water, better than the water that he is drinking from. So this son of Adam, becomes eager to go under that tree and drink from that water next to it, because it's better than the tree that he's under and from the water that he's drinking from. So he says, Ya Rab, allow me to go under that tree and drink from that water next to it. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says to him, O son of Adam, how selfish are you? Didn't you agree with me that you're not going to ask me for anything else after I gave you what I just gave you? So he says, Ya Rab, you are the most generous. You are the shakur. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, then I'll allow you to do that if you don't ask me for anything else. So he goes under that second tree and drinks from that water, relaxed and so comfortable, thinks that he is the best Muslim ever existed on the surface of this world after what Allah has given him. Because he knows he does nothing for Allah to give him that. And then while he's there, he sees a third tree, better than the two trees that he was at, and a better water river next to it. So he says, Ya Rab, allow me to go under that tree and drink from its water, drink from its river. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Oh son of Adam, how selfish are you? You promised me you're not going to ask me for anything else. So he says, Ya Rab, you are the most generous. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says to him, I'll allow you to go under that tree, but don't ask me for anything else after it. So he goes, and he sits under that tree, so relaxed, drinking from that beautiful river that's flowing next to it, so comfortable. And while he's there, he thinks that no one has been granted, no one has been given to him what he has. And he says, "Utitu ma lam yu'ta ahadun min al-'alamin." Allah has given me what he did not give to anyone in the world. But then, while he's under that tree, drinking from the water, he starts to hear noises. What kind of noises? Not noises like the noises and the sounds they used to hear in the hellfire. People being punished and tortured. But this time he's listening and he could hear people laughing. People are happy. He could hear people in the birth are so comfortable and happy. He could hear sounds of happiness. So he looks around and he sees the people of the paradise in the paradise. What does he see? Allah Azza wa Jalla will open for him a window. They could see the people of the paradise, in the paradise, having fun, happiness, comfort, beauty. So he looks and he says, Ya Rab, who are those? And what's this? So Allah Azza wa Jalla says to him, that are the people of the paradise, in the paradise. So he says, Ya Rab, allow me to be with them. Allow me to enter the paradise with them. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says to him, didn't we agree? You have agreed with me that you're not going to ask me for anything else. And you insist that you continue to ask and ask and ask and ask. But he says, Ya Rab, you are the one that described yourself as the Lord of the universe. You are the one that described yourself as the most generous one. You are the one that described yourself as the shakur, as the one that gives a lot for the little that the people do. So Allah Azza wa Jalla will say to him, O my servant, how about I'll give you 10 times what the most richest king had ever had on the surface of this earth, and you enter the paradise. So Allah Azza wa Jalla lets this man enter the paradise with 10 times as much as the most richest king had ever existed on the surface of this earth. Why did Allah Azza wa Jalla do that? For what? Because he is the one that named himself Ash-Shukur, the appreciated, the one that gives a lot for the little that you do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a lot for the little that you do. And that's why my brother and my sister never ever look down at any good deed that you could ever do. لا يحقرن أحدكم من المعروف شيئا. As the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام says, don't look down at any good deed that you might offer for the sake of Allah. You give for the sake of Islam. You give for the sake of the Muslim. You might give something so little, but you find it so great in the hereafter. This is the quality of the Muslim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be that. And Allah Azza wa Jalla has named himself as the Shakur, as the appreciative, the one that gives a lot for the little actions that you might give. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to give us the understanding. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts to Him so we could understand what He wants from us, so we could do what pleases Him. My brothers and my sisters, always do what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that Allah azza wa jalla will continue to give you more than what you give. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.